Good morning, Chapel Hill. We hope you all are doing well. If you are visiting with us for the first time, we want to say welcome, and we're very glad that you're here today. And we would love to get a little bit of information from you. And as you are all making your way to your seats, in front of you there are blue cards that say, hey. And for our visitors, this is where we would like to just get three little bits of information from you so we can share with you about our church. We got one standing, not standing up, but it's in the air right there. We want to give you a little bit of information about our church, and we want to be able to share things, and we would like you to ask us questions. And so the best way we can do that is to establish a connection in that. So if you wouldn't mind filling those out, and during the service, we're going to pass the offering buckets and just drop those off in there, and then I will get in touch with you this week. So I have a couple announcements for us today. Tonight is our spring family picnic, and that's going to begin at 4. And we've told everybody bring individual bags of chips, but also not individual desserts. You can bring whatever dessert you want. We're going to have a dessert table. So it can be individual, or it can be chocolate pecan cookies that Angie said she was going to make tonight. So those are, now you're accountable. So you can just bring those tonight. Everything's going to start at 4, and Lori's going to have an egg hunt for the kids. And so we just want to invite you all out here to have fellowship and community with your Sunday school classes with each other as a church family. So we will see you at 4 for that. And also, Easter is coming up. It's next weekend. We are a week from Easter. If you are going to be participating in our Easter outreach project, where we go and we're inviting the community to church, and we're going to go put little bags of invites on each door, we need all the help that we can get with that. And if you can participate in that on Friday, Mr. Jimmy and Mr. Terry, where are y'all? Okay, they're in different spots. On Friday, that group is going to go, and if you would like to participate on Friday, they are going to decide the times closer to that date, and so if you will contact them, their information is on Facebook, or you can let me know, and I'll get you their information. On Saturday, for the teams that are going out Saturday, we're going to meet in the Family Life Center at 9 o'clock, and so we need everyone to help as much as they can, whether it's an hour or whether it's 30 minutes. We need everyone to help so we can get these on the door. So be here at 9 o'clock on Saturday morning. And the last thing, on April 16th, we're going to be having our members meeting, and you can see the agenda there. I apologize, my eyes are dry, and I cannot read that, so I apologize for that. But that's the agenda, and the agenda is also on Facebook, and it was in your email yesterday, and we'll continue putting the agenda out. Damon wanted me to share, see if I can read this too, who are the members we're going to be voting for the Finance Committee are Terry Warren, Kathy Harris, and Stephen Brassfield. So this is our announcements for today, and we are so glad that you're here. I'm going to encourage everyone to stand up, and let's welcome each other. And I would encourage you, if you sit up front, there's a lot of people in the back you may not know. So take time, go to the back, and see people you don't know.
Love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace, give God man to us. doing this morning? Man, it's great to see all of you. When we see Jesus, man, it's going to be something. Scripture this morning is out of Matthew 21, 8 through 11. It says, most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth, Galilee. I hope there's only two crowds here. There's a crowd that was praising God, and there was the crowd that was looking to see who he was. I hope this morning you're part of the crowd that is praising him, and I hope you know him. Let's take our offering buckets and pass them out to the edges, and we'll get that out of the way. It's good to see all of you this morning.
Let's lift that up, church. Praise is rising. Thighs are turning to you. We turn. Worthy of all our praise.
Yeah. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never.
We said that, church, your promise still stands.
Still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness.
I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me.
Worship time this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope you've all had a great week. I pray didn't anyone here suffer any damages from Friday night storms. That was intense to say the least. Amen. We definitely lift up those who have suffered losses. We saw pictures and heard reports of much destruction across our area. You know, I saw in Little Rock, Arkansas, Covington, McNary County, Adamsville area. It breaks your heart, all the devastation. Please continue for all. Prayers continue for all, and I'll stay in contact, letting you guys know with our GBA association, see if there's any reports of immediate needs we can help out with. And like I say, I'll make sure the church knows. I mentioned Brother Mike Kemper yesterday, who's our director of missions, and he said he knew that there was some disaster relief chainsaw teams already going out, but he would keep us posted. So I'll pray right now. Let's pray for all this. Lord Jesus, God, we come before you this morning, Father, and we lift up, God, all these who have been in the path of this destruction of bad weather we've had over the last few days, Lord. And God, we just want to lift up all the ones who suffered loss, and God, even those who have suffered loss of life, Father. And Lord, we just pray for families, for strength. God, we pray for you to be here this morning, God. I know that you are welcome, God, and I just pray that you move mightily and freely, Lord, as we look at your word, God. We love you, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The past 5 or 6 weeks now, Wednesday nights, we've been going through a study titled Not a Fan, by Kyle Idleman. It's been a great study, one that has been very challenging personally, and I know for others as well. In the study, it challenged us from the beginning to do a DTR. I don't know if you understand what a DTR is, but it means define the relationship. The study continues, and each week it continues to ask us to basically evaluate our walk. Are you a fan of Jesus? Or are you a follower of Jesus? So how, I want to ask you this morning, how do you think you would answer this? How committed are you? I thought I knew what I would say before this study, but it has definitely made me realize how short I fall. But challenges me to die daily, to say, not my will, Father, but yours. I gave those who have been attending a daily journal to go through that helps you be intentional at looking at your relationship with Jesus. It's a simple journal, but powerful. Again, intentional. So this morning, I want to ask you, how committed do you think Simon Peter was to Jesus? Our text this morning is Matthew 16, verses 21 through 25. So if you've got your Bible, Matthew 16, verses 21 through 25. Matthew's gospel says that toward the end of his 3 years of public ministry, starting at chapter 16:21, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Hearing this, Peter took Jesus aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord, he said. This shall never happen to you. The Bible says that Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will find it." Well, there are a few words Jesus ever spoke that are, to me, are scarier than these. That's particularly true when you compare them with some of his other invitations. When Jesus says, "Come dine with me, come experience my fulfillment," most of us are pleased to accept that invitation. When Christ says, "Come do life with me, experience the difference hanging out makes," many of us are you know, naturally intrigued to do that. When Jesus says, "Come dance with me, come experience my joy," well, it seems like a good deal to follow him. But when he says what he says here, when Jesus says, "Come die with me, come take up a cross with me, come experience my death," there is something in almost all of us that cries out with the Apostle Peter, "Never, Lord." And that's only natural. Because from the cradle on, we are taught that the goal of life is to preserve it. From the moment we're first strapped into our child's safety seats to the day we're lying in a hospital room with someone like me visiting you and praying for your health to improve with tubes all in our bodies, the continual message is preserve, protect, secure, sustain. It is not simply the maintenance of life, but it's maximizing each day that we are taught growing up here in America. I remember talking with one who has since gone to glory, Miss Louise Bynum, about her long life as she was close to 100 before passing away. She loved to read, and God blessed her with good vision in her 90s. And she would tell me often, "Mom told us that if we lived long enough, we'd get old." Meyer writes, "From early on, we absorbed the message that the quality of one's life is directly related to the quantity of the life enhancements we have been able to secure. Our lives come to be defined by the titles and trophies we've gained, the pleasures and privileges we enjoy, our castles and expensive toys." And then along comes Jesus. He tells us that we have defined life too superficially, too selfishly. He looks right into our eyes as he did the Pharisees and tells us that we're barely touching life as God intended it. He tells us to get off the fence. We've been walking between the world's ways and the kingdom's ways. He challenges us to complete the circle of grace and not just demand it for ourselves because we've got a ticket. He calls us to evaluate the pleasures we've allowed to invade and conquer our hearts. He tells us to check our bags for the anxiety, the fear and anger we've been carrying so long that we don't see how burdened and blocked we still are by it. Jesus demands that we give outrageous grace to those who wish us harm. And if we are truly hearing him, then we rightly recognize that the coming of Jesus requires somebody's death. If we're going to follow Jesus through the gate of the kingdom, if we are to be born anew into this life of God, then the way we've been taught to define life, the way we've naturally come at life, the life or self we've become has to die. It has to be lost. It has to be named and nailed and destroyed. And that will be painful and hard. It will demand something of the profound humility and courageous perseverance we see in Jesus as he carries his cross. It will mean periods of time when we feel utterly forsaken by God. It will put us in a place of temporary vulnerability before the soldiers and mocking crowds of this world. It will mean cleaving to our spiritual family the way Mary and John were called to by Christ at the cross. It will require a daily commitment of our spirit into the Father's hands. It means a trusting obedience until God's work in and through us is completed here, and we can say, it is finished. George MacDonald, the great Scottish preacher, once wrote, "Christ died to save us not from suffering, but from ourselves. Not from injustice, far less from justice, but from being unjust. He died that we might live, but live as he lives, by dying as he died. Who died to himself that he might live unto God. If we do not die to ourselves, we cannot live to God, and he that does not live to God is dead." During Holy Week, we are accustomed, I know, to focus on the death that the Palm Sunday crowd eventually called for. But if we stop there, we miss much of the meaning of Good Friday and the Easter beyond. It is equally crucial that we remember the death that Christ called for. This death Christ calls for is a price entirely worth paying. It is the path to communion to God Himself. It is the road to an eternal peace that surpasses all understanding. It is the only way to gain an unshakable faith, an unconquerable hope, and a life-changing love more precious than anything the crowds chase after. But this is what Jesus makes clear. This life doesn't come from simply wearing a cross. It comes from bearing a cross. Somebody, some life, some self has to die. Now I can take the parts of the biblical Jesus that I like, the ones that reinforce my lifestyle, that leave me feeling spiritual without much cost. I can wear a cross as jewelry without feeling any need to bear a cross as a disciple. I can go on with life as I have it. I can keep the self that I have. But I don't want that self. I want a better self. How about you? Don't you want the self that Jesus shows you? That Jesus says can be born in you? The kind of self he apparently gave to Arlen D. Williams Jr.? Does that name mean anything to you? Probably not. Maybe, unless you've spent time in the Washington, D.C. area. Listen to this. There's a bridge by that name that crosses the Potomac River. And on January 13th, 1982, when Air Florida Flight 90 iced up upon takeoff and crashed into those icy waters moments later, there was the struggle to rescue the small number of survivors who treaded water for their life. Among the survivors was Arlen Williams. As the Washington Post tells it, five different times, a helicopter dropped a rope to save Williams. And five times, Williams passed the rope to other passengers in worse shape than he was. When the rope was extended to Williams the sixth time, he could not take hold and succumb to the frigid waters. His heroism was not rash. Aware that his own strength was fading, Williams deliberately handed hope to someone else. Again and again and again and again, in the most difficult circumstances, Arlen Williams made the choice to die to self, and in so doing became a glorious life that never dies. There is a bridge to new life that stands in a place where someone else once made some deliberate choices. "No one takes my life from me," Jesus said to Peter and the other disciples shortly before walking to the cross. "No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord." Jesus said, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. I tell you, the man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. For whoever serves me must follow me. That's John 12, 23 through 26. We gather today to remember that when he might have elected otherwise, Jesus chose to take up his cross, to pay the ultimate price for human sin, that you and I might be forgiven and live forever with God. Jesus chose to pass to you and me the rope of salvation. If you've never taken hold of it before, I pray you grab hold of it today. But once you've done that, don't stop there. Don't let the cross be merely a symbol of the life Jesus had or that you'll have in heaven. Let it be a signpost to the life of Christ that calls you into this world. Cross over the bridge and into the life of the kingdom of God. You know the way to that city, don't you? It's the way marked out by Jesus, by Arlen Williams, and by every soul in every home and church and workplace and town who keeps making the difficult choice, the disciples' choice. If you would come after me, said Jesus, you must deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. Sometimes this call and cross causes us to tremble. But church, it's the tremble of new life. So how can we do this? This concept of dying daily, meaning when we do, we are dying to change. I want to give you a few ways that can help you. First is a word that can be hard for many and something that is not easily attained. Trust. If we are to die daily in Christ, we have to trust Him. Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. Verse 6, in all your ways acknowledge Him and He will make your paths straight. The Hebrew word for trust means to lie down on, to put your entire weight on something. When you go to sleep, you lie down in your bed because you believe it is strong enough to hold you. With all your heart means entirely, without exception. So in essence, God says, trust me completely. I can sustain you. Your own understanding won't support you. Proverbs 28:26 says, whoever trusts in his own mind is a fool, but he who walks in wisdom will be delivered. Every day God is growing and molding me. Amen? Every day. Oxford language defines trust: firm belief in the reliability, truth, ability, or strength of someone or something. Merriam-Webster defines trust: assured reliance on the character, ability, strength, or truth of someone or something. If you were to be asked what the word trust means to you, what would you say? Listen to this story I ran across. We were approaching the fourth hole on the golf course one afternoon. Suddenly the sky turned ominous and it began to rain amid claps of thunder. We rushed to shelter in a gazebo near a metal fence. As the storm grew in intensity, a bolt of lightning hit the long chain-link fence, and it lit up like a neon sign. It was a while before any of us could speak. Then one player turned to his opponent and said, you know that five I had on the first hole? It really was a seven. Trust is formed with someone when you spend time with them. It's hard to tell for sure when it's just a casual acquaintance. But when a lot of time is spent, you get to know and trust them more. How about with God? This study I mentioned earlier by Kyle Idleman, I'm not a fan, it challenges us to look at a walk with Christ to whether we truly follow Christ or we're just fans of Christ. A quote from the journal that went along with the study: when Jesus said to Matthew, follow me, he was making it clear his invitation to follow is not just for the religious elite, for the morally upright, or for those who have their lives together. His invitation is for all of us who are are hiding stains. Jesus said, anyone who would come after me must deny himself, take up his cross daily and follow me. And anyone is a pretty inclusive word. Anyone can follow Jesus. Anyone who ever thought to themselves, I've gone too far, my stains are too big. Anyone who has ever lain awake at night and said, I can't believe what I've done. Anyone who's ever looked in the mirror and said to themselves, I can't believe what I've become. Anyone can follow. Anyone who knows down deep that they've got really nothing to offer Jesus really is what Jesus offers us that changes things. On the day he said to Matthew, follow me, something changed in him that day. And how do we know all this about Matthew's life? How do we know about his past failures and mistakes? Because it tells us. Church, it's a very challenging study, and I strongly suggest if you get a chance to go through it. Wednesday night, folks, don't miss this Wednesday as we wrap up the study. But this morning I ask you about your trust in God. He wants to know you more. Plus, check this out. The deeper, the more intimate, the more genuine, the more real your relationship is with God, old Slewfoot is more fearful of you. Amen? God desires to have a close, intimate, personal, loving, dynamic, powerful relationship with you. But listen, Christianity is not about just a weekly trip to church on Sunday. We must go beyond that. How many times have we asked people, are you a Christian? And how many times have we received the answer, I go to church? Well, that doesn't tell you much. The question is, are you in love with Jesus? The real question is Jesus your Savior and the Lord of your life? Are you walking in obedience? Church, there's so much darkness outside these walls. We are called to be the light of the world, but far too many have forgotten to turn their lights on. We've got an opportunity, church, this weekend to go out in the neighborhoods of Medina and invite folks to Easter services next week. Let us know you want to help with this. We desperately need to get serious about what is going on in this world and what is going on. We need to get serious about what's going on in our own lives. We need to understand one day we're all going to stand before Almighty God and make an account of our life. Amen. The Bible says in Matthew 7, 21 through 23, listen to this. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name, drive out demons in your name, and do many miracles in your name? Then I will announce to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you lawbreakers. Church, it is time to submit. It is time to obey. It is time to be real. It is time to be mature in the faith and develop a close relationship with God. And we need to become followers of Christ and not just fans. So my first key is trust. Really, really being truthful and trusting with God. To hold nothing back. Do not hold on to certain areas of your life that are just for you. Don't just put them over here. Jesus said, everything that the Father has is mine, and everything that I have belongs to the Father. I ask you, church, are there areas of your life that you're holding on to that you have not given to God? Church, it must be first in everything. The second key is time. If you desire to have a close relationship with God, you must put time into it. I'll tell you right now, if you do not put the time in, you will be wishing for and you will never receive a close relationship with God. If you will not give him the time, then God really does not have first place in your life. He doesn't. You've heard said there's a God-shaped hole in every one of us. And nothing fills that hole except God. Amen. Oh, how I could take the rest of the morning to testify on this. So many times God extended his mercy and grace on me. So many times. I can remember so well one of the nights that I wound up in a drunk tank in Dyer County Jail after a night of partying in a near fatal car crash. This should have shaken me so about the lifestyle I was living as I tried to fill that missing God-shaped hole with Bud Light. But it didn't at that time. But listen, church, God put people in my path that shared the good news with me. Thank you, Jesus. A lot of us have tried to fill that hole with something. I'm here to tell you, no position at work, no boyfriend or girlfriend, no husband or wife, no child, no friend, no amount of money will fill that hole. Nothing's going to fill it. Only God. We must get serious in our relationship with him. When you search out Jesus' life in the scriptures, one thing you'll always find, he spent much time alone with the Father. He always spent time with him. He always made time for the Father. We are strengthened in our relationship when we spend time with God. Now, if I asked, and we were all truthful, how many of you have difficulty spending regular, quality fellowship time with God? Probably a lot of hands would go up. Church, the devil fights us that hard. The devil does not want us to be in conversation with our Heavenly Father. I caution you to think about what your God time consists of. Not just occasionally listen to a sermon online or audio. That's good. But we need regular time daily with him. You need to come to God one-on-one so he can give you revelation. I'm convinced that one of our biggest problems is that we hear or see so much, and yet none of it gets deep. None of it impacts our very being. God is clear. We need to meditate on our conversations with God, and we need to read to chew on and digest the scriptures. They have to get down into our very soul and become revelation. God has a great personal plan for your life, church. He will give you the strength and the ability to do it. He will give you the knowledge and wisdom to complete it. You have to make an effort, church. You have to persevere. You have to be steadfast and refuse to give up. You have to give him the time. You must make time to be with him, one-on-one. And remember, no discipline in the beginning seems joyous, but keep at it. Keep at it. The benefits are great. Amen.
Amen.
In 2002, everything about God became so real to me, and I'm still learning and growing today. You know God does speak to us, right? How can you read the scriptures and not know that God speaks to us? Jesus is clear. Hear God's word. Scripture says in John 10:27, my sheep will know my voice, and the voice of a stranger they will not follow. A mature relationship with God is refreshing, full of excitement. If you will just open up and realize that he is interested in every aspect of your life. Every aspect. Remember Christ's words to us? Matthew 22:37. Scripture says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. Passionately, you should love God. Scripture says, Matthew 22:39, and the second is like it. You shall love who? Your neighbor as yourself. Matthew 10:37, whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. God so desires an intimate relationship with us all. So it's time for us to grow up, to be mature in the faith. God wants to be involved in every area of your life. So don't shut him out. Let him in. And listen to this. Everything becomes sacred when God is in it. Going to work, meeting the girls at Child Wagon on Thursdays, even fixing a water leak on a Saturday can be just as holy as going to church if you go with God. Amen. Everywhere you go, you'll desire to give someone a word of encouragement. You'll desire to put a smile on someone's face. You'll want to make someone feel better. You'll earnestly watch for needs and be ready to meet those needs. It will become such a part of your DNA, you'll be so excited about your life that you will hardly know what to do. Church, you have a purpose, and that's to let your light shine. Amen? Live in love and love to live. Church, our battle is not against other human beings. Check this out. What's it say in Ephesians 6:12-13? For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. There is an unseen realm that is just as real as this realm that we see and live in. And there's godly protection there, but there's also much wickedness. There's evil and demonic forces that won't and that will come against you. But be clothed with the armor of light. And when you spend time with God, and when you put on Christ, you put on that light. You put on that new nature. God will give you the strength. God will give you the energy. So trust in God. Give God the truth. Give God the time. Church, we are called to deny self and to follow Jesus. Luke 9:23 says, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. I know this is hard, but we are to die daily. So church, take time, make time to be with God. And when you do, you will hear his voice and he will guide your paths for his name's sake. And a trust will develop that will give you peace, knowing that come what may, God is in control, and he's got this. Amen? I want to ask Brother Mark if he wouldn't mind coming up as we prepare for invitation. Today you may be saying, Brother Mike, I've heard the expression before of dying to make a change, but you've completely lost me with this dying daily stuff. If anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life because of me will find it. Listen, God wants you to know how much he loves you. All of you. And his word tells us how we need to live. As we looked at this morning, it involves a daily decision that we all have. The Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Maybe you find yourself here today and have never made Jesus Lord and Savior of your life. Or maybe you're just not sure. Scripture says that today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. I want to just take the next few minutes to tell you how you can invite Jesus into your heart. First, understand everyone's a sinner. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. The reason we come short of God's glory, God's righteousness or perfect nature is because all have sinned. All includes me and it includes you. Sin is nothing more than disobeying God. It's not just murdering or stealing. For example, Adam and Eve ate from the tree that God told them not to touch. That was their first sin. So the first thing you must do to agree is agree with the Bible. Admit to God that you are a sinner. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. Everyone owes a sin debt. By wages, the Bible means penalty or debt. There are consequences for sin. Just as a criminal must face punishment for his crime, so must we pay a penalty for our sin. This penalty is death, an eternal death, which is also called the second death. Revelation 20:14-15 says, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So secondly, you must realize that if you die in your sins, then you must pay the penalty for sin by dying in hell forever. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Although sin brings eternal death, God wants to give us eternal life. You must realize that you cannot gain eternal life by going to church, by being baptized, or by just being a good person. As a matter of fact, it is a gift of God. You can't buy or earn your way to heaven. Eternal life is obtained through Jesus Christ alone. John 14:6 says, Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrated his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So the third thing you must believe is that Jesus has paid your sin debt by dying for you. And eternal life is only gained through him. Church, everyone can be saved. Although Jesus died to pay everyone's sin debt, not everyone is on their way to heaven. You must personally receive God's gift of eternal life. You must believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose again for you. And ask him to save you. Romans 10:9 says, if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, that you will be saved. Romans 10:13 says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.